When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they were in great fear. The exact place where this took place is known through modern archaeological research, and the biblical notes help us. The Egyptians pursued them, all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and his horsemen and his army, and overtook them encamped at the sea by Pi-hahiroth in front of Baal-zephon. So we can trace exactly where it was, and one can see why this happened. The people of Israel cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, "Is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt?" And then this complaining, which is a leitmotif we see always in this Exodus, "Is not this what we said to you in Egypt? Let us alone, let us serve the Egyptians. Slavery was better." It's always greener on the other side. But they had, humanly speaking, reason to be alarmed. They were hemmed in, and the only way out was the way forward, the sea. That can be seen quite clearly from the spot where this was happening. And that same modern archaeological research indicates that what followed did follow. The miracle took place, and the proof is that the Egyptians are still to be seen under the water, not their skeletons, but their chariots, not clearly, but clearly enough to see that this is what happened, because there is a constant. There are a lot of shapes, now completely covered in coral growth, of what are actually obviously chariots. It's perfect. They're on the seabed at that point. And the evidence goes on that they did make it to the other side. Salvation history is also chronological history. They got there, and they got there through the sea. They certainly didn't go back or take another route. So this chosen people was brought to this land for a reason, and that land was to be the tabernacle of the Most High after a long pedagogy, because they were formed, first of all, in the desert. They had the law given to them, they had that long period of 40 years of formation by God Most High, Moses being a direct link, and they had this true revelation. God is one. Monotheism was there. Their customs were purified, the Sabbath became important, one marriage was given to them, very different from the peoples of the East of the time. And therefore, when it came to the incarnation, providence had prepared the way. We too tend to complain. We too tend to look back. We can't see what the Lord is doing. But as the Old Testament says, the arm of the Lord has not been shortened. And it is this same power that we have, for we have the fullness. And the Lord indicates that when precisely talking about other cultures. He talks about the evil and adulterous generation asking for a sign, but strangely enough, goes to other cultures to make a point. As Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, points to the resurrection as the big sign, but indicates that actually he will be their judge. The men of Nineveh will arise at the judgment of this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here. The same then for another non-Jew. The queen of the south will arise at judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, something greater than Solomon is here. That also applies specifically to us who have the fullness of the sacramental system. Why? We have not less, but more than the Jews of the time, insofar as we have now fully operative all that the Lord wants to give to mankind after Calvary. Now, it is true that man has to some extent messed up what God had intended by creating splits and divisions. But because God is God and wishes well to mankind, he will always find what may give him access. If he possibly can, he will find a chink. It is only when there is no chink left that he can't do any more, and the soul is its own undoing. God, on his part, always offers and tries. But there is something very sad about the way that he tries very hard, specifically there where he's given the fullness, and finds one big problem. The hardness of the heart, of which precisely he accused the people of God in the Old Testament. Hardness of heart, a very Hebrew expression. The language is always concrete. And hardness of heart comes in when time after time, God is being generous with his grace, and we are refractory. We don't respond, or we respond in a way that is abusive. It does happen, and it happens a lot in the house of God, and even directly in the things of God. Now, when translating the Purgatory manuscript, this problem came up, and I was puzzled by this answer which came back with regard to the judgment of Protestants. And I was glad to see that actually the Lord was very much at work. They had fewer graces and therefore had a rough time with regard to what might help them in the beyond. After death, little praying was going on for them, and they didn't have the helps that we have at the moment of death. But there was the fact that they oftentimes did not abuse the grace that they had, and that one does see. That is why one sees that actually the power of preaching becomes almost sacramentalized by the free gift of the Holy Ghost, insofar as because God is the lover of mankind, he will use very much what is going to get through to an immortal soul just in time. And so, incomplete truth, because it can actually ignite the soul, may actually carry much grace, and the Holy Spirit will not be absent in that moment of sanctifying grace, which comes when a truth hits a soul in darkness, a movement from the outside to the inside of the family of God is positive. Let's never forget that when handling a soul in incomplete truth. Keep going in the same direction. This I picked up very much when studying Welsh history. In Sunday school days, at the age of 13, our Sunday school teacher used to take us to places. And one of the places that he took us to was Talgarth, a church in Mid Wales, or right, to be more correct, slightly south of Mid Wales. We used to go through it quite often on the way to our grandparents in Mid Wales. And there, the exact spot where it happened was marked. And we know exactly what happened. It was in 1735. At the time, it seems that Wales was somewhat drowsy. Old Catholics' instincts had been there for a long time, but the priesthood was not available to them, and so it was becoming anemic. But then something unexpected happened, indicating actually how God loves mankind and does his best wherever he finds any chink and opening. It was this young man, Howell Harris, who was in church on the Sunday before Easter, I believe, and he heard this sermon from the Reverend Price Davis in the pulpit in Talgarth Parish Church, Anglican therefore. He could see that hardly anyone came ever to Holy Communion. Indeed, Howell Harris had never been to Holy Communion. And he preached in this vein. You say that you are not fit to come to Holy Communion. I say, then you are not fit to come to church. Nay, you are not fit to live. You are not fit to die. And like an arrow, burning arrow, it seized his heart and conscience, and he made a huge U-turn, and he began to convert others. 2 years later, William Williams of Pantycelyn, a farm that we also visited, the future great hymn writer, heard Howell Harris preach, and he also was ignited. At the same time, Daniel Rowland was fully ignited, and the three of them, with others, put the whole of Wales on fire, swept like a hurricane. Now, we must remember that the business that we're in is the salvation of souls, and we must not forget the power, even the sacramental power, as it were, of the word on fire. For when preached well and heard well, it changes the will, and by that the whole of eternity. As St. Paul the Sixth said, let us not leave unto others the work of evangelization.
He's the Lord. He's the Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is the Lord. Every wish shall come. Every time comes. Mm-hmm.